Welcome to Nightbeat Studios. We are pleased to introduce Nightbeat Presents, a series presenting personal interviews with recording artists and an insider's view of the music industry. Episodes will feature established performers and introduce new artists. Our first episode features well-known studio musician, producer, and solo artist Louie Shelton. Our interview with Louie spans his 30-year career and provides an extraordinary insight into the life of an LA session player. Louie Shelton is viewed as a supreme session guitarist, able to deliver the right notes in the right place at the right time. His versatility with rock, R&B, jazz, blues, and country made him very much in demand by recording producers and film composers. The impressive collection of artists who have benefited from Louie's talents include the Monkees, the Jackson 5, Diana Ross, Boss Skaggs, Marvin Gaye, Smokey Robinson, Thelma Houston, John Lennon, Stevie Wonder, Ella Fitzgerald, Quincy Jones, Ringo Starr, Sammy Davis Jr., Peggy Lee, Rita Coolidge, Nancy Sinatra, The Temptations, Kenny Rogers, The Partridge Family, The Osmonds, Gladys Knight, Barbara Streisand, Whitney Houston, Joe Cocker, Seals and Crofts, Lionel Richie, The Carpenters, Neil Diamond, and many, many more. Thank you for joining us this evening, Louie, and we're delighted that you're here. Let's start out by having you tell us what artists you feel have influenced your music.
I suppose early on, the biggest influence for me was Chet Atkins. And when I was 12 years old, I was trying to be a Chet Atkins clone. And I would learn all of the records that he had made. Another favorite player of mine was Merle Travis. And I used to get the thumb pick and the fingers going. Do all that sort of stuff as a kid.
Oh, that's some impressive playing for a 12-year-old. Anyone else?
The guys that I sort of idolized as guitar players, Barney Kessel, Johnny Smith, Wes Montgomery. A good friend of mine, Reggie Young, who's been a session player in Nashville for many years, first told me about those guys. And I pretty much learned to play by ear. I never had any formal training or couldn't read to play the guitar. So I went out and bought all their records and would listen for hours and hours trying to pick what they were doing.
Louie, what did you learn from each one?
Barney Kessel was really good because it was sort of a departure from the country music that I had learned to play, and he was playing a lot of the major sevenths and stuff. Then I found out about Johnny Smith, and I got his albums, and Johnny was a very fluent single line player. He also played beautiful chords and big stretches and stuff. Like he's known for that hit record called Moonlight Vermont.
I see.
A short time later, I went out and got my first Wes Montgomery album, which was the incredible jazz guitar of Wes Montgomery. And I loved the way he played the octaves, which we hear so much of today with the modern players, especially on the smooth jazz stations. And I used his technique on the Lionel Richie record, Hello.
Began playing professionally?
I started playing on a radio show with a band. We were on 5 days a week. And we did a TV show every Wednesday night. and Saturday Night Jamboree. This was all in Little Rock, Arkansas, where I was born and raised. When I was 17, I decided to, I actually took a gig in Santa Fe, New Mexico. It was my first time to leave home. The latter part of my stay in Santa Fe, I was able to put together my own band. We were basically a cover band.
Well, Louie, how did you make the transition from a performer to a session guitarist?
We were packing the clubs and doing about as good as we could do in Santa Fe. And so many of the touring bands would come there and say, man, you guys should go to L.A. You'd do great out there. So eventually we said, okay, well, we can't do any more here, so let's go to L.A. And by this time I was 21. And the night before we were supposed to leave, the whole band chickened out except me and the drummer, Donnie Cotton. But we were packed, so we went ahead and went to L.A. And the only person I knew when we got there was Glenn Campbell. Even though Glenn Campbell had taken me around to meet some people, it's very hard to crack the studio session scene in L.A. or Nashville or New York or any place, because most of the producers already have the guys they like to use because they've been successful with them in the past, and they just don't want to take chances in trying new guys, no matter how good the recommendation is. So I ended up having to do publishing demos to start out with, and I was fortunate in that two of the guys I did publishing demos with, Tommy Boyce and Bobby Hart, they were signed to Screen Gems Publishing at the time. They managed to get the deal to write the songs for the Monkees when that whole thing developed. So they called me to play on those tracks. After that, you know, in L.A., producers ask each other, you know, who'd you use on that record? And Boyce and Hart were very popular in Hollywood there. And so they spread my name around, and I started getting calls from everybody.
Oh, wow, what a great break for you. Louie, would you please describe for us a typical day for a session player?
During the course of a day of sessions, we might work with three different artists, and they may be three totally different kind of artists. For example, our Motown sessions usually ran from 10 to 1, and that was pretty obviously what kind of work that was. That was always the R&B, like the Jackson 5 and Diana Ross and Marvin Gaye, Smokey Robinson. And when that session was over, we might go across town to another studio, and it might be, you know, the Monkees or Paul Revere and the Raiders or, you know, any number of different artists. So you had to start thinking a different kind of music. And then that night, maybe we might be doing Barbra Streisand or Andy Williams or someone like that. And that would call for yet another, you know, way of thinking and, you know, usually in some ways more sophisticated kind of chord changes to their tunes and stuff like that. So you had to be a bit flexible.
Rock, R&B, jazz, blues, and country all on the same day. That certainly does require an awful lot of versatility. So tell us, what was one of your favorite sessions?
I got a call from David Page and said that he's got this guy coming down from San Francisco by the name of Boss Gags to do an album, and would I be interested in playing on it? And I was already producing at the time, but I said, sure, I'd love to. So we showed up for the session, and it was Jeff Beccaro on drums and David Tungate on bass and David Page on keyboards and myself on guitar. And Boz was there singing in the room with us, and it was a real natural, fun kind of a session, and the tunes went down really well.
Louie, when you were called to a session, how did you learn the material that you were asked to play? Were the guitar parts written in notation form?
If you were one of the first call session guitar players in L.A. during the 60s and 70s especially, you were expected to come up with hit licks and fills and guitar licks that framed the kind of record they were trying to make. And if you couldn't do that, then you wouldn't get called back for the next record. They'd call someone else that could. So I worked real hard at trying to figure out, trying to think as an arranger, where does it need guitar, what kind of guitar does it need, what kind of effects, what kind of sound, and is the guitar just a background instrument now, or is it really going to be up front?
Oh, I see. Well, I think we're all interested to know what was some of the best advice that you've ever received.
One of my early acquaintances in the session scene was Hal Blaine, and he gave me some good pointers. He said, you're a great player, he says, but sometimes when you're playing rhythm, you're trying to push ahead just a little bit, which is a natural tendency for most guitar players. He said, so just remember, when we're doing tracks, the drummer is God, so, don't be pushing the drummer.
So you worked exclusively on sound recordings?
During that period that I was doing sessions, I also did a lot of TV work. I did the Campbell Show for 2 years. I did the Smothers Brothers Show. I did the Danny Kaye Show. I did some Johnny Carson shows. We didn't just get called for record dates, we'd get called for movies. And I was able to do movies with Henry Mancini and Quincy Jones, Dave Grusin, Lalo Schifrin, people like that. And that kind of work would have a very wide range of music that you would cover. The Lalo Schifrin stuff was all very, tightly written out, and those charts were really a headache for me. But then we'd get with someone like Quincy Jones during the early Bill Cosby shows, where it would just be myself and a bass player, a drummer, and a piano player, and he would say, I need 20 seconds of blues and B-flat about this tempo, and he'd just count the tune off and we'd play some blues, which was very easy. Of course, he would get his $200,000 for counting it off.
I want that job. Louie, as a producer, your greatest success was with Seals and Crofts. When did you realize you had your first hit as a producer?
Wes Farrell came in and said, I was down in Palm Springs, and man, I kept hearing Summer Breeze on the radio. You got a hit there.
See the curtains hanging in the window.
I said, oh, no way I could never get a hit. Because I was, even though I'd produced the Seals and Crofts record, I was still doing sessions. That was my main gig. We were lucky and got got him a hit with Summer Breeze and Diamond Girl and Hummingbird and We May Never Pass This Way Again and quite a few others.
How did you improve their music as their producer?
Since I wanted to get a bit more feel into their tracks and not as much of the folk content that was on their first two albums before I was involved with them. And it seemed to work in a nice way for them and made them very radio friendly, having a bit more rhythm in the tracks and a bit more feel into those songs.
Louie, one of today's most respected jazz guitarists, Larry Carlton, says you are one of his biggest influences. Well, how did you come to know Larry?
He was playing an after-hours club. I think he was like 16 or 17 years old. Someone had told me about him, and I'd gone down to see him. The first guitar player that did the Partridge Family sessions with me didn't quite work out, and so Wes Farrell asked me if I knew anyone and said, yeah, I've got this kid, he hasn't done much, but he's, you know, his name's Larry Carlton. From that point on, Larry became a very busy session player.
So guitar was your first solo release?
We found a track on there called Reflections that radio has taken a liking to, and they've been playing that for over a year now on the jazz stations here. One of my favorite tunes off my first album called Guitar is a tune that I think brings together the two worlds of traditional jazz and smooth jazz in kind of a nice way. It's called Solo.
Hot and Spicy is the current one, is that right?
I'm hoping that we'll get some good airplay on that new record. One of them that we all feel has some great potential for airplay is a tune called Satin Dreams. Thank you. another tune off the new album that is a bit more high-spirited, and I felt like it reminded me of animals running across the African plains, so I called it Serengeti.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. We hope you'll come back again.
Sure, I'd love to.
Louie Shelton, a young boy from Little Rock, Arkansas, who with talent, a little luck, and a lot of hard work became a very successful session guitarist, producer, and solo artist. We encourage you to check out Louie's music, and we're confident you're going to agree he's one of the finest guitarists in the smooth jazz industry today. This is Kelly Cullis for Nightbeat Presents, reminding you that if you have a dream and you're willing to work hard at it, you can accomplish anything.